Hello, everyone, and welcome to the market analysis video for Wednesday, March 18th, 2020. The markets are doing what the markets do in a market crash. They're whipping around a little bit. We saw a test at 240. The breakdown failed. We're still below a 5, 10, 20, 50, 200-day moving averages. So, you know, we're oversold for a while. We could stay oversold or we could have a bounce. And I've talked about this before, that the bear market bounces are just as aggressive as the sell-offs. A good example, on Friday last week, we saw 10% to the upside. One of these times we're going to string together multiple days in a row of that kind of energy. Cliff notes here is, if you're looking to short, you probably don't want to shorten the whole right now. If you're looking to reshort, just wait for one of those massive moves. But that's not what we're going to talk about today, because the markets, equity markets, are honestly, they're important, but they're not as important as other markets right now. We are in the midst of the budding credit crisis. And that is the main risk that the Fed cares about. One of the myths that I think that a lot of people have is that the Fed cares about stock price movement. They really don't give a hoot. I'm going to try and keep this as PG as possible and not cuss. But they don't care that the market is down 10%. They care about credit. They care about lending windows. They want to make sure that businesses will not collapse during this pandemic. And so we can analyze stocks to death, but that is not what will normalize conditions. There are other indicators to look at. There are other markets to look at that will give us a much clearer picture of when we are out of the woods. And a lot of this is more macro stuff. Once these conditions improve, the market will have already bottomed. Okay, so this is more of a long-term set of ideas, but I thought it was useful because these are things that we, you know, I haven't looked at the TED spreads since 2011. Okay, and I look at it every once in a while, but now it is a little bit more important. And there are some other indicators that we can look at that I also think are pretty important as well. Okay, so this is a list of things to watch, and this is in no particular order. All right, and I'm just going to try and pull up a couple charts. So first off, TLT. The first question I'm going to have is, will TLT go absolutely bananas back to the upside and clear above 165? If you see TLT above 165, something very bad is happening in the bond market. We saw a capitulatory climax in bond yields. We saw the 30-year Treasury get below 1%. That's never happened before. There was a forced buy-in, a forced liquidation of short Treasuries. We don't know who was involved, but it was on a massive scale. Okay, the good thing to happen for markets will be for yields to go up. One of the things you have to understand is that there's a couple different ways to think about Treasury yields, but basically it is a voting mechanism on inflation versus deflation. When yields are very, very high, the market is expecting not just economic growth, but asset price growth and other things like that. If bond yields get too high, that's way too much inflation, right? The converse can happen as well. If everyone thinks a lot of deflation is going to happen, then yields go down. All right, so there was this voting mechanism that occurred, and there was a breakout back in December. We saw a ramp up in February. And then, I don't even know what happened. On TLT, 145 to almost 180, that's an unprecedented move in the Treasury market. What we saw yesterday was the worst sell-off in bonds in the history of bonds. Okay, so this big fat red candle, that's never happened before. And that was in response to a fiscal package from the U.S. Right now, treasuries and government debt are almost a voting mechanism on the fiscal response from the United States. So if you want the market to be better, you want TLT to go down. If TLT stops going down, something bad has happened. All right, so that's the first one. The next one is corporate debt. And what we are looking at here is JNK versus LQD. This is something I've watched for a very long time. We'll just try and widen this out a little bit. So what this shows us is the ratio performance of JNK, which is a junk bond ETF, relative to LQD, which is an investment grade ETF. Now, as a whole, all of them have sucked, right? We'll just hop back on a regular charts for a second. So we saw BND flash crash, right? We saw corporate debt ETFs get absolutely shmammered last week. That is when the Fed started introducing extraordinary lending facilities because the corporate bond market broke. And that is what the Fed gives a hoot about. Because if you have a company that has debt in the form of bonds, and they can no longer generate enough cash flow to cover their debts, they go bankrupt. And then equity prices go to zero. Okay, that's the risk. That's why the Fed cares more about credit, because equities are equities. They're going to move whatever. But if credit breaks, then equities are a binary event. They either recover or they go to zero. So we're seeing flash crashes, where we saw a flash crash and an absolute breakdown in corporate bond markets last week. All right, so as an example, you really don't want to see BND sell off anymore. You want to see it recover. Ideally, you would want to see it get back above $85. But we can look at the ratio of how well junk bonds have been performing relative to corporate grade debt. This is a risk appetite measurement. And as you can see, we're back to levels not seen since 2016. So, right, this happens every once in a while. We see pretty strong pullbacks. What we don't want to see is this. All right, if we see movement like we saw in 2008, then we're going to have 2008-like results. And that's not what we want to have happen. All right, and that I'm okay with being a little bit more... You know, when we look at stocks, we can be a little bit, detached from price action. We can say, okay, we don't care if the market's going to go up or down. We just want to make money. This is more macro stuff. I do care that credit facilities remain open, because if they don't, very bad things happen outside of financial markets and into my personal life, right? So we want to root for this thing to not absolutely collapse. A push above 85 would be very beneficial to a normalization in the market. So we want to see the ratio JNK relative to LQD go back above 85. The next thing that would show us normalization is going to be crude oil. So we had the Kingdom of Saud come out and flash crash crude down 20% last week. That certainly hasn't helped things. We're seeing crude oil get back below 25. Just like how treasuries, through some heuristics, through some mental models, show us inflation-deflation relationships, crude oil shows us the economic growth prospects on a global basis. That has decoupled over the past few years as we've transitioned more towards other energy sources. You know, we've got a lot of natural gas in the U.S. and that and fracking has certainly brought on a lot of supply to the markets. But especially in the U.S., fracking companies cannot turn a profit at these prices. And if they can't turn a profit at these prices, they lay off a lot of people, and that hurts the economy. It's also a voting mechanism on global economic growth, right? If no one is getting in an airplane, the air companies don't have to buy oil and they don't have to refine that oil. And so it's almost a proxy for economic growth. We want to root for crude oil to get back above $35 a barrel. That's basically the gap down open. All right, so above that would tell us that there is more of a normalization in the energy markets again. All right, so we've looked at treasuries, we've looked at junk corporate spreads, we've looked at crude. We can talk about some volatility really quick. We have the VIX, which is the spot VIX, right, which measures the supply and demand for S&P options. There's also a second indicator called the VIVIX, which is the supply and demand for VIX options instead of S&P options. For the market to normalize here, we want to see VIVIX get back below 140. All right, and that one's pretty simple, all right, because we don't want people in a panic buying in a bunch of VIX calls and VIX futures. Because what happens when they do that, the market maker ends up short VIX, and then they have to go to the futures market to cover by getting short. And then that provides fuel to the fire to the downside. Okay. If we see a move and hold sub 140, that shows us better conditions in the options market and less dislocations. VIX, we want to see a VIX underneath 40. Honestly, that's going to take a while, I think. I think we've hit a new normal where, you know, I think 30 is going to be the low. And I think that we are due for a sharp pull in the demand for S&P options. But in order for that to happen, we need to see the market stop moving 5% a day or 10% a day. If that happens, that's normally going to happen after some kind of strong rally and then sideways action and volatility compression. Okay. But for us, a VIX sub 40 would show us more normalizing conditions. Some other things. Where did it go? I'm using for this current market, one of the things you could have done in 2008 during the crash is look at the performance of specific companies with respect to their debt, right? So you could look at Lehman and Bear Stearns, or you could look at Countrywide. And say it's not just about equity prices, but what are the bond yields doing and what is the performance of their corporate debt? So instead of looking at all corporate debt out there, you could drill it down to a handful of companies and use that as a proxy risk indicator. So my proxy risk indicator is going to be Boeing, right? Because Boeing has gone from 400 to 100. It is probably one of the most sensitive companies to this current environment that I've seen. You could look at airlines, but Boeing has exposure not just to building planes, but other things in the defense industry and so on. So I am watching the performance of Boeing debt. All right, so this is just generic Boeing debt. You can see when it crashed right here. So it was trading at par, currently trading 85 cents on the dollar right here. It's currently I don't know, that doesn't look right, but okay. Anyways, we want to see credit conditions for Boeing to normalize. And that's probably not going to happen until we get out of the woods for a while. It may take a while, but that would tell us that conditions have normalized and the market returns to normal, and then we can go to more traditional option trading strategies. All right, so that's another one I'm watching. And then, close enough. The Treasury Euro dollar spread is a credit condition. It is a credit signal for us. And if this goes higher, bad things happen. That's the simple way to put it. You can see when it exploded back in 2008 right here. And that was a bad thing that happened. Right now, it's spiking up. It's at the highest level we've seen since 2009. Okay. We want to see the TED spread go sub 50, not 50 cents, but the ratio 0.50. We want to see 0.50 on the TED spread. That would indicate normalizing economic and macro conditions, and the market will stop falling apart. Okay. So what have we got? TLT, we don't want it to go apeshit higher. Junk corporate spreads to normalize, crude back above 35, VIVX sub 140, VIX sub 40, Boeing bonds normalize, TED spreads normalize. And one more thing that's a little bit more of a short-term indicator is going to be this. This is the NYSE McLellan Summation Index. And it's got an 8-period moving average, exponential moving average. And this is just a simple thing to follow. All right. This is a simple on-off switch. If this indicator gets above its 8-period exponential moving average, that is going to be a much better environment for long-based ideas. And you can see how it did in 2019. That sucker was basically the low right there. It's also possible that we see something like we did back October where it crossed over and then it fell apart again, right? But it's a pretty good signal. It's a bit of a lagging signal, so it's not going to nail the absolute bottom in the market, but it's going to tell you that breadth conditions have normalized a little bit more. And then one more thing, you know, we've got the COVID stuff, so you can just keep an eye on this and look for things. And so this is a dashboard that's put out by ARCGIS, and it's something I've been watching for about month and a half. The one everyone's focused on is going to be the US and the US numbers. My thesis here is that the market hates uncertainty and the market likes uncertainty. Even the market likes certainty, even if the numbers are awful, right? So as the US gets more testing done and as we get true numbers coming in, it doesn't matter if those numbers are truly terrible. But then the nerds at the brokerages can start plugging them into their spreadsheets and extrapolating what company earnings will be. We will also start, once that happens and once we get a rough idea of when this can normalize, and it doesn't have to be 100% certainty, but there's a transition to certainty for the markets, we will start seeing companies issue guidance. And boy, is it going to be ugly. Right? We're going, like, a good example would be something like Disney, where Disney has gone from $140 down to $90 a share. And, you know, the parks are shut down, movie production shut down. The only thing they really got going for them is Disney Plus. They cannot, as a company, issue guidance to their earnings right now because they don't know. Because we do not have enough COVID data out. Once the COVID data comes out and it's going to be bad, then these companies will be able to extrapolate that into how much they can sell over the next quarter and over the next fiscal year. And that's also going to be, I mean, it's going to be a train wreck. But it's going to get priced in. Once it gets priced in, stocks stop selling off. So what'll happen here is Disney's got earnings in May. They'll probably warn in April once we get enough COVID data out. It's going to look like dog shit. And we won't sell off on it anymore because these companies, you know, they're going to look at their stocks and they're like, all right, we've already got cut by a third. We're just going to throw out the baby with the bathwater and get all of the bad news out right now and just rip the Band-Aid off. And when that happens, stocks bottom. The best example I can show you is Apple from 2018. During this really, really nasty crash that Apple had, ran from 230, right? 230 down to 150. What happens? Well, what happened was this earnings report right here, they said, we're not going to release any more iPhone sales numbers. The stock sells off. You have this gap down right here where they guided down on earnings and guidance and they said, everything looks terrible. And what happens to the stock? It goes straight up from there. So that is the next thing to start watching for. We're going to get COVID data out. These companies will be able to price it in better. They will start releasing guidance that's going to look terrible. And then the stocks will not sell off on the bad news because the bad news got priced in, and that's when these stocks bounce. You get enough of those stocks doing it, that's how you get a sustained market rally. That's all I got for now. If you have any other questions, let me know. Have a great day.